For today are that Joel is preaching. Yay, thank you God. It will be lovely to hear his story. I'm sure we will all be strengthened and encouraged by it. And there has been a group meet to see about reopening. We're going to continue the Zoom program all the way through until forever, God willing. And we are looking at starting again in September. There's a lot of things that we have to do for the conference. There are a lot of things we have to do for the state to make sure that we're able to open. And so we're gonna do it low and slow, sort of. Maybe there'll even be a vaccine by the time we open, in which case we can hug one another and greet one another and sing together, which will be lovely. Let us now say our prayer for deliverance. Give me a pure heart that I may see thee, a humble heart that I may hear thee, a heart of love that I may serve thee, a heart of faith that I may abide in thee. Amen. And now our call to worship is Psalm 23. So say as much of it as you want. This is a good psalm to memorize for those times when you are frustrated or anxious. And it's just the first three lines or so can heal many troubles if you have them in your heart. So let us begin with Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. And now our opening hymn is Jesus es mi rey soberano. And I'm going to ask Joy to play it through once because I don't think we've ever done this hymn before in our worship service. Thank you. Children's sermon taught to us by Susan Johnson. Newly prepared.
Hi. Good morning. Well, it's been an interesting week, I think, for all of us. And I looked with great interest at what the scripture was today that Pastor Hoel was preaching on. Now, did you tell me that it is Reverend Dr. Hoel?
Yes.
It is Reverend Dr. Hoel. And that's a wonderful thing to think about when we're talking about where should we get reliable information. The sermon today, the scripture today is about Daniel. And it is Daniel, and it has surprising confluence with what is happening out in the world. We see a king who is arrogant. We see a king who has no regard for religious objects. This king is having a party, and he is pulled out all of the Jewish relics, the sacred objects of the Jews. And they're drinking wine and getting drunk and doing probably not very reverent things. And suddenly a hand appears and writes on the wall. And the king, even though he's incredibly drunk, is horrified. And it goes on to see that he is looking for reliable information. He's looking for someone that can tell him what this all means. And I think that today we are all looking for something, for somebody to tell us what all of this means. And in the end, he finds in Daniel a reliable source of information, but he has to hunt around. And I think today that it's really important that we look around and we see what is reliable information. He didn't find it right away. He had to work at it. He didn't, one of his wives came in and said, hey, there's this guy named Daniel and maybe he can help you. And I think that we have to look hard for where is reliable information, because there's a lot of writing on the wall today. It reminds me of the Simon and Garfunkel song, Sounds of Silence. You know, that I now probably can't remember, but the words of the prophets are written on the subway walls and tenement halls. And I think that we need to look and see what that is telling us and lean back and cement our reliance on the Lord and our reliance on the fact that this too will pass. And the object is to make it pass successfully, to learn from what we're doing now. And you hope, as I hoped when my hip popped out, that whoever is taking care of you knows what they're doing. And we know that our Lord knows what they're doing up there, and they're taking care of us. And all God's children said, amen.
Amen. Amen. The Lord's Prayer now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now we get to hear the piano offertory solo. I want to remind everyone to go online and listen to this, because the video feed is much cleaner than the Zoom feed. So if you're unhappy with what you hear today, go online to our website and watch and hear Joyce.
YouTube. Go to YouTube.
Go to YouTube.
From our website.
From our website. Yeah, there's a link, a YouTube link. So, and then you'll hear what it really sounds like. Okay.
Thank you.
grateful to God that we found joy to share her great God-given talent with all of us. What a blessing. Let us now sing our doxology. Thank you to all the people who have been mailing in their pledges. Thank you and bless you. And thanks for supporting the work of the Lord through Bardsdale United Methodist Church. Okay, our doxology. Nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. In Jesus' name. Amen. And now our hymn of preparation is Tell Me the Story of Jesus. Ready to receive the word of God. Send your spirit to fill our lives with your love, that we not only hear but do your word. Amen. And now Carmen and Joel will do the reading of the scripture and the sermon. And
Alicia is going to help me with the reading of the scripture, and here it is.
Daniel 5, verse 1 through 12, the writing on the wall. King Belshazzar gave a great banquet for 1,000 of his nobles and drank wine with them. While Belshazzar was drinking his wine, he gave orders to bring in the gold and silver goblets that Nebuchadnezzar, his father, had taken from the temple in Jerusalem, so that the kings and his nobles, his wives and his concubines, might drink from them. So they brought in the gold goblets that had been taken from the temple of God in Jerusalem. And the king and his nobles, his wives and his concubines, drank from them. As they drank the wine, they praised the gods of gold and silver, of bronze, iron, wood, and stone. Suddenly, the fingers of a human hand appeared and wrote on the plaster of the walls near the lampstand in the royal palace. The king watched the hand as it wrote. His face turned pale, and he was so frightened that his legs became weak and his knees were knocking. The king summoned the enchanters, astrologers, and diviners. Then he said to these wise men of Babylon, "Whoever reads this writing and tells me what it means will be clothed in purple and have a gold chain placed around his neck and will be made the third highest ruler in the kingdom." Then all the king's wise men came in, but they could not read the writing or tell the king what it meant. So King Belshazzar became even more terrified and his face grew more pale. His nobles were baffled. The queen, hearing the voices of the king and his nobles, came into the banquet hall. "May the king live forever," she said. "Don't be alarmed. Don't look so pale. There is a man in your kingdom who has the spirit of the holy gods in him. In the time of your father, he was found to have insight and intelligence and wisdom like that of the gods. Your father, King Nebuchadnezzar, appointed him chief of the magicians, enchanters, astrologers, and diviners. He did this because Daniel, whom the king called Belshazzar, was found to have a keen mind and knowledge and understanding, and also the ability to interpret dreams, explain riddles, and solve difficult problems. Call for Daniel, and he will tell you what the writing means." The word of God for the people of God.
And I'm going to read it in Spanish for the people who are connected in Spanish, if you allow me to do so. Belshazzar, rey de Babilonia, invitó a un gran banquete a 1,000 de las altas personalidades de la nación. Y durante la comida, el rey y sus invitados bebieron mucho vino. Excitado por el vino, el rey Belshazzar mandó traer las copas y tazones de oro y plata que su padre Nabucodonosor se había llevado del templo de Jerusalén. Las copas y tazones fueron traídos y bebieron en ellos el rey, sus mujeres, sus concubinas y todos los demás asistentes al banquete. Todos habían sabido y bebían vino y alababan a sus ídolos hechos de oro, plata, bronce, hierro, madera y piedra. En aquel momento apareció una mano de hombre que, a la luz de los candiles, comenzó a escribir con el dedo sobre la pared blanca de la sala. Al ver el rey, la mano que escribía se puso pálido y de miedo que le entró, comenzó a temblar de pies a cabeza. Luego se puso a gritar y a llamar a los adivinos, sabios, astrólogos de Babilonia y les dijo: "El que lea lo que ahí está escrito y me explique lo que quiere decir, será vestido con ropas de púrpura, llevará una cadena de oro en el cuello y ocupará el tercer lugar en el gobierno de mi reino." Todos los sabios que estaban al servicio del rey entraron en la sala, pero nadie pudo entender el significado de lo que escribió y lo que estaba escrito y explicárselo al rey. Entonces le entró tanto miedo al rey Belshazzar que su cara se puso completamente pálida. Las personalidades del gobierno no sabían qué hacer, pero la reina madre, atraída por los gritos de su hijo, el rey de los grandes y los grandes personas invitadas, entró en la sala del banquete y dijo: "Que viva su majestad para siempre, y no se preocupe, ni tenga miedo y se ponga pálido, que en su reino hay un hombre guiado por el Espíritu de Dios Santo. Cuando el padre de su majestad era rey, ese hombre demostró tener una mente clara e inteligente y sabiduría como la de los dioses. Por eso el rey de Nabucodonosor, padre de su majestad, nombró a ese hombre jefe de todos los magos, adivinos, sabios y astrólogos de la nación, ya que en Daniel, a quien el rey puso el nombre de Belshazzar, había un espíritu extraordinario e inteligencia basta y ciencia para entender el significado de los sueños, explicar el sentido de las palabras misteriosas y resolver los asuntos complicados. Llame su majestad a Daniel y él le dará conocer el significado de lo que está escrito en la pared. Esta es palabra de Dios para el pueblo de Dios. Thanks be to God. Gracias a Dios.
Okay.
Yes, I just looking my notes, sorry. Well, first of all, thank you, extended family of Bartel UMC. Gracias, familia de México, que se están conectando. There are some new names in your screen, probably from my family in Mexico. So I'm going to preach the whole thing in English first, and then I'm going to do a summary in Spanish because some of my family, some of my siblings understand English. So that's a blessing. A blessing from school and from our parents who always push us to learn and to always find outs and means to equip ourselves to be better, to be wiser. And as I said, thanks be to God for this time together. Thank you for your opportunity, Pastor Bethany. And also thank you for my family to be in this time with me, which is very special for me. But I want to highlight a person right now before I start, a person who endless hours, endless time to be with me, walking with me in all this process to be and finish my doctorate, which is my beloved Carmen Julia, mi esposa. Le quiero dar gracias a Dios por ella y por todo el esfuerzo y esas horas que ella sabe que pusimos. I'm so thankful for all the hours, all your kindness, all your patience, because were a lot of hours to study, to find information, to type information. And also I want to say thank you to my kids because they were patient and supportive of me as my family. And with that being said, let me start with the exegesis of the text, and then I'm going to explain what is God in the Graffiti about, which is a project. And finally, I'm going to finish with a little testimony. So let me start with the text. Explain us what is going on in that particular place, in that particular time, with a king that wasn't really respectful about God and respectful about the things that are offered to God. In this case, some objects, you know, some cups, some plates, some things that were offered and made for the use of God's purposes. And this guy wasn't really, you know, aware of what he's doing, but God was. The lesson, a very specific lesson for us to understand. When God take control of something, he is going to the very end, really control everything, including what is an object, what is something, you know, like a cup. And this guy was party, was drunk, and was really happy and said, "Hey, bring all these beautiful objects from the Jerusalem temple to drink because they are so beautiful and I want to drink in those cups," and so on and so forth. I was, you know, thinking what he's thinking in that time. But for his surprise, something sudden happened. And you just read, a hand start to write on the wall and start to put it a message. And if you keep reading, you are going to find the message. And the message is very clear and very, clear for Daniel, not for the king, and very update for the people of that particular time about what they are doing. And it's amazing how God used any kind of way to give us his message and explain us what is about, what is in his heart, what is in the heart of God, And the message was, mene, mene, tekel, parisin, which means God is here. His kingdom is among us. And you are going to see something from God. The majesty and the power belongs to him. And his majesty and his kingdom now is divided and is in your hands. Pretty much is what it says. Mene, mene, teke parisin. So with that in mind, a pastor, Pastor Bill Macruz from Plaza United Methodist Church, came to my office. As some of you know, I'm the director of Hispanic Latino Ministries and Board of Concerns. And my job is to help churches and pastors to develop programs in their churches to be more efficient to approach and and have this connection with the Hispanic Latino community in the U.S. So this church, which is in the very center of downtown, has some situations with graffiti. As any big city, graffiti is all over. So she was thinking to use some kind of program to develop some approach especially the youth and young adults who do that. So she has a clear idea. I want to use art for this particular project, Pastor. So we were, talking and sharing, and this Bible verse came to my mind among another Bible verse who is in Exodus. The Bible verse Exodus is about the Passover, remember, when Moses received the order to kill, and put the on the entrance of the house, put a mark, with the blood of the lamb. And that's another kind of symbolism and use some kind of painting, some kind of expression which is not a word. It's an expression of art, let's say, let's put it that way. So with those texts in mind, I start to develop the idea with Pastora Vilma. Pastora Vilma allowed me to use this idea, and she was pretty much the one who helped me to put more meat, more content in this particular project. And of course, in that church, we developed the project, in fact. And was a blessing to see how this project start to evolve, because it's really interesting that even though it's a piece of art, in my opinion, all these kids, all these youngsters, young adults who wants to express themselves, not in the most good way, more respectful way, because they tag, the places. We start to think how we can connect with them and provide a place and something to tag or to paint. So we start developing the idea, and we finish doing things like this. Approach to those guys, which was very difficult because you don't know who is the person who tagged. So we were looking from schools, we were looking at the streets, we were trying, and we spent more than 6 months to find at least one. And God provide a person, just one, young adult, who connect us with another five, and that's the starting of the project. And after that, we decide to invite them to the church, not to listen a sermon, not to have a Bible, study, but to talk about their issues, to talk about themselves, to know themselves and have this connection with them. And after that, we invite them to have a round table with people who knows about the history of Los Angeles, people who knows about art, people who knows about all kinds of topics that they want to talk about. And after they listen, these people, they start to asking questions. And in those encounters, we call these encounters, the artist and the people who knows about art and history talk, and then they discuss, and the artist start to grasp some ideas and to grasp something to draw later. Then a couple of weeks later, we provide a canvas, with spray paint, and a time outside the church to paint, whatever they want to paint. And it was a real nice process, because these kids and young adults are no longer using the walls to paint. The church provides a canvas, the church provided the paint, and also the church provide the space outside the church in the big plaza there in downtown Los Angeles. The church asked the authorities to use the space for a couple of hours to do the painting. And you are going to see some pictures at the very end of this presentation. And then we see that these guys start to engage with that. And we explain that the art is something that came from the heart, and the heart and the mind and all the body is made by God, and they made by the image of God. And they start to see all these kind of connections, start to be more open to discuss about God, about baptism, about other issues, about so on and so forth, about religion. And it was really, really nice to have these encounters with them. We have 3 encounters in total. And we, at the very end, we have this connection with the kids. They still in connection with La Plaza UMC. One of them is kind of a regular at the service. It's not that that type of service that he wants to be, because it's a service, an old-style service. But he's still in connection with Pastora, and the other 4 still in connection with Pastora, because when Pastora wants to do something for the church, can you give me, you know, some kind of piece of art to use in my bulletin or whatever? So the kids do the thing. So thanks be to God for that particular thing, because we know and we are aware that there are so many ways that God uses to speak what he has in mind. In the case of the scripture, was a tagging on the wall, was some letters, some words, which is graffiti, which is what we know as a graffiti. But God used those things to express his will. That's why I use that particular action. And even though the connotation of graffiti nowadays is bad, I'm sure, and I can have some kind of proof that if we use that bad thing, if you want to call that, which is not bad because art is not bad for me, we can use for God purposes, can be a blessing to the people who are part of that project. So with that being said, I'm happy to share that was my topic of my last piece of work. 120 pages writing by Carmen and me, because she's a good typer, so I spend time with her, and she types all my ideas and correct my Spanish. Everything is in Spanish, because that's the other thing. My final work is in Spanish, because I want the Spanish community to have it. Hopefully I can translate later on that particular work for the English speaking community as well, because this is something that every church can use. I designed some kind of strategic plan to follow. Every church can adjust whatever they want. But the main thing and the main conclusion, or my main conclusion as now a doctor, which is, by the way, my first preaching as a doctor, my first preaching through the internet. So thank you, because you are my guinea pigs. No. You are not anything. You're my friends. And I can share with them that the main thing that I learned is the connection, the real connection with a human being, with these kids who has all kinds of problems, all kinds of anxieties, all kinds of questions that they don't find an adult who can answer those questions in a kindly manner, in a listening way, in a willingness to help that particular kid to understand that it's not good to write on a wall. It's good to use art for express expression of their heart and mind and everything, ideas. But it's not good to use a wall, which is not their property. And that's something that I learned. The connection, the interaction between the people who knows about the topics and these guys who wants to know more and want to ask questions. And they connected and they, you know, produce a beautiful work. As I said, Carmen is going to share in the other computer this beautiful work. And I don't know if Carmen is ready. Are you ready, mommy? And after these pictures, I'm going to give you my final word, which is a testimony. This is a part of the connection that I said. There is UCLA teachers. There is a councilman over there talking with Pastora Dilma is the one who has their hands up. And the other ones, the grafiteros, are the kids who are sitting on the pews. And they are explaining points and asking about that particular time was about the history of Los Angeles, because some of the kids wants to know more about the history and how the downtown evolved and transformed from a poor community now to new developments, very expensive, by the way. And then we ask for permission, as I said, to use the plaza, which is close by. And they start to do their work. They start to produce their paintings, and they start to, you know, to invite people to be there. And we put a table also for kids who wants to do something in the meantime. So that was on Saturdays after the talking 2 weeks prior to that. And there is Quincy, the one who helped us to find the other ones. And there are another two kids just, you know, doing their work. And again, and another topic, another gathering, talking about the next topic, about how is the conjunction between religion, gangs, and also politics. It was very interesting, that one, by the way. And the, you know, the kids just do their homework, and they finally they produce some pieces of art, and was amazing, was really amazing. And I don't want to overwhelm you with so many pictures, so that's okay, mommy. But that's pretty much what is about this produce. Later on, I can put, you know, the presentation and some of the pictures. I can send it to Barzil UMC just to see the final pieces of art, because they are very interesting, some of them, and are very very enlightened for understand what is in the mind and the heart of these particular youth and juveniles, and how they express their opinions. You know, Quincy, just to mention one, Quincy did one beautiful one that you are going to see with a lady in the center, and around the lady it's so many buildings, and also some people, and she expressed that the center is an angel, because angel, the city of Los Angeles in Spanish says La Ciudad de Los Angeles, which is Los Angeles City. She said, this is an angel here and people around, and the angel is always there. So was very interesting, his opinion about the history, and that was about the history. With that being said, I'm so blessed and so glad to be among you, and very humble. I said, you are my family, you are my extended family, and I bless for that. And I now I'm more responsible to share my understanding of, you know, things and knowledge, because I'm one of the 0.0002% of Hispanics who got this particular degree, which means that none of us Hispanic community got those levels. And I feel responsible to keep sharing, to keep helping others, to say, si se puede, you can do it. To invite young adults to say, you can transform your lives and you can be better, wiser, and useful, you know, in the city. And I took this opportunity to say thank you for the people who inspire me in my church in Mexico, there were two people who really inspired me among so many. Dr. Daniel Beltran Maldonado, and also Obispo and Dr. Alejandro Ruiz, who were people who inspired me, who preach in my church and help me to understand what's going on with the effort to study on to the very end. To the very end, I spent 49 years studying until this very moment to finish the whole cycle of studies. And I'm glad for that. And of course, I want to say thank you to my mother and to my father who always support me, always allow me to dream, says, you can do it, Joel. But I cannot write this essay in first grade. You can do it, Joel. I cannot finish this piece of work, of my architecture work. You can do it, Joel. Just take time, sleep well, eat well, go to church, pray, and all these kind of things that mothers and fathers say to us to encourage us. And of course, I want to say thank you to my brothers and sisters. I have four siblings, Josué, Jorge Isaac, Laura Catalina, and Mayra. Thank you for your kindness and always your support and your words and your prayers as well. And of course, as I said, my beloved wife and my kids who always support me to be wiser, be kind, and be bold. And my boldness especially came from my older brother. I want to say a word. He always, probably because I'm the second, I'm in competition with him. He always has better qualifications, better marks, and he was my example. And I'm glad that he read my whole thesis, my whole work, and he said, you did a good job. And I said, finally, he said, I did a good job. So I'm glad for Josué, who helped me to read my entire work. And now, for the sake of my people in Spanish, I'm going to give them a brief roughing of 3 or 4 minutes. Please allow me to do so. La predicación se basó en el texto de Daniel, donde Daniel viene a explicarle lo que significa lo que el rey ve en la pared, ¿verdad? Y les explicaba que Dios usa muchas maneras para hablarnos. Dios usa esas situaciones que ahora consideramos graffiti, pero en ese tiempo no tenían esa palabra. Y en este tiempo se usa como una cuestión negativa. Pero yo lo tomé como algo negativo que Dios puede usar en algo positivo. Y realmente la idea no fue totalmente mía. Quiero agradecer a la pastora Vilma Cruz, que vino a mi oficina. Hablamos, diseñamos el proyecto y ella me ayudó en su iglesia, porque yo no tengo iglesia actualmente, yo soy supervisor de iglesias. Me ayudó a poner en práctica esto, ¿verdad? Y vimos, por la gracia de Dios, cómo esto se iba agregando, ¿no? Cómo Dios usaba ese texto y el texto también de que el pueblo de Israel tuvo que poner sangre en los dinteles de la puerta. ¿Se acuerdan en Éxodo? Que también eso es una expresión de arte. Las manchas esas, es arte finalmente, es graffiti finalmente, si lo consideramos como graffiti. Y Dios lo usa para hablarle a su pueblo, para decirle algo a su pueblo y a no su pueblo, ¿verdad? En el caso del rey, porque el rey no tenía ni respeto de Dios, ni respeto de las cosas de Dios, como eran los objetos del santuario, ¿no? Entonces, tomando esa idea, yo la transformo con la ayuda de la pastora en un proceso en donde los primeros pasos fue encontrar a los jóvenes para poderlos reunir, conocerlos, interactuar con ellos y después conectarlo de acuerdo a sus preguntas, a sus necesidades, con expertos en historia, en sociología, en política, lo que ellos quisieran pintar y conectarlos, ¿verdad? Para poder hacer el trabajo, ¿no? Y esto floreció de tal manera que esos jóvenes, después de 3 encuentros, de 3 reuniones, ¿verdad? Primero con ellos, después con los expertos y después al pintar estos 3 pasos, 3 veces se hizo esto, participan en la iglesia. Uno más que otros, pero los 5 están en conexión con la pastora y le ayudan cuando ella necesita algo de arte para sus predicaciones y demás. Y idealmente, pues le doy gracias a Dios porque es algo que se puede hacer en cualquier iglesia y por eso lo tomé como objeto de estudio al final, ¿verdad? al final de mis 49 años de estudio, son los que he estudiado para llegar a ser doctor, que le doy gracias a Dios porque estoy en poquito porcentaje, 0.0002% de hispanos que llegamos a este momento. Y no solamente lo digo ligeramente, sino con mucha responsabilidad, porque ahora mi responsabilidad es invitar a otros, traer a otros, ¿verdad? Ahora, concluyo de todo este trabajo. La iglesia tiene que hacer trabajo así. Tiene que ver fuera de sus cuatro paredes. Conectar a la comunidad con Dios, ¿verdad? De alguna manera. Y puede ser el arte, puede ser otras cosas, ¿no? Y termino diciéndoles también, esto es básicamente lo que expliqué. En la tarde les explico un poquito más, familia. Que le doy muchas gracias a Dios primeramente por mi esposa Carmen Julia, ¿verdad? Que me ayudó en todo lo largo de este proceso de doctorado, no solamente con su oración, no solamente con su presencia, con su paciencia, sino físicamente, muchas correcciones. Ella es mejor escribiendo que yo y tiene mejor ortografía y gramática que yo, así que gracias, amor, gracias, 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 mi amada Carmen Julia. Pero también le doy gracias a Dios a papá Joel y a mamá Alicia, que siempre me empujaron a hacer lo mejor. Y siempre me recordaron que yo podía. Y nunca me negaron la oportunidad de soñar. Y de soñar en grande. Y a ustedes, Josué, por sus lecturas y su redacción. Y obviamente por todo lo que antes nos ayudó como hijos y como hermanos. A Jorge, por su dedicación y su empeño. Su ejemplo, ¿verdad? De ser exitoso en lo que se propone. Por Laura, por su paciencia, por su fe. Y a Mayra, obviamente, también por su ánimo, por su candidez, ¿verdad? Y obviamente a sus familias, ¿verdad? Gracias, gracias, familia, por eso. Y le doy, por último, la honra y la gloria a Dios por todo eso que ha hecho. Y a la pastora, ¿verdad? A la pastora Vilma Cruz, que me ayudó a poner todo esto en práctica. Y esto es para honra y gloria de Dios. So, to be God the glory, now and forevermore. Amén. Para Dios sea la honra y la gloria. Amén. Amén. And that's it, Pastora, for me.
I look forward to seeing those pictures, those paintings at some point. It'll be lovely to share those with us. Gosh, you got me thinking about what we can do around here. So thank you so much for that.
Post them on our webpage.
Yes, that's an excellent idea. Post them on our webpage. Heather Nielsen can do that for us. So. Blessings, blessings. What a great gift you are. Well, what a great gift you are, and Carmen and your family, to this congregation, this community, and to the world. Blessings, blessings to you. Okay. Let's do... don't like that prayer of confession. I'm going to have to change it. Okay. Let me read this prayer instead, and then we will do our closing song. Merciful God, Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now let's sing our closing song.